to know that we'll be advertising for a church administrator this week. The advert will be appearing in the church Facebook page and the Cooter Community Council Facebook page. So this is really just to let you know about that, and if there's any friends of yours or colleagues or contacts that you may have that might be interested in this, the job specification will appear as a link to the little advert, and we'll welcome any applicants. Mark, it's good to have you back with us again this morning, and thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you for the welcome, and it is good to be back in this lovely stretch of weather in this midsummer season. So can I bid you all a very warm welcome to, not too warm I hope, a warm welcome to our worship here in Cooter this morning. Some words from St. Paul. Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. So we continue in worship as we pray. Let us pray. Dear God and Father, we pray that as we come and gather in your house on this your day, that you would be pleased to accept our worship as a pleasing sacrifice. We ask that you would open our mouths to praise you, open our ears to hear your word, open our eyes to see your glory, and open our hearts to experience your grace. And all we pray through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I stumbled over a phrase there because it was open our mouths to sing your praise. Next week, you will be able to open your mouths, I'm afraid with face masks, to sing God's praise. But today, for the last Sunday, we enjoy the praise that other people will provide for us. And so we have our first hymn, 110, Glory Be to God the Father. Joining us through the Facebook live stream, we welcome you to the service as well. And so we continue in worship as we unite together in prayer. Let us pray. Creator God of this midsummer season, as we continue into these sacred days of lingering daylight and warm breezes, of colour-lined window boxes and sun-bathed park benches, we worship you as the God of new beginnings. We worship you that at the beginning of time and space, you gave us a world and you filled it with the useful, with granite, with gravity, with grapes. And you gave us minds and hands to engineer the granite, to probe the forces of gravity, and to squeeze the grapes. At the beginning of time and space, you gave us a world and you filled it with the beautiful, with marble, with moles, with marigolds. And you gave us compassion and imagination to shape the marble into sculptures, the moles into medicines, and the marigolds into tapestries of bronze and yellow. At the beginning of time and space, you gave us a world and you filled it with the comic, with croaking bullfrogs, with the buoyancy of water, with duck-billed platypuses. And you gave us, as image bearers of God, a sense of humour and different ways of seeing in order to delight in the world. At the beginning of time and space, you gave us a world and you filled it with mystery, with living cells and dying stars, with black holes and the speed of light, with human beings. And you gave us dominion over the earth to till it and to nurture it with curiosity and creativity. And so as we begin through this summer season, we are mindful that we are passing through a season of change and new beginnings, a season of confirmations and graduations, a season of retirements and moves, a season of weddings and celebrations, a season of terms ending and holidays beginning. O God of new beginnings, please be our constant companion and guide through these times of transition. Please be with us through the endings and the beginnings, through the goodbyes and the hellos. Please walk with us from the known into the unknown and remind us, O God, that just as you care for the earth at all times and in all seasons, you will care for us in all the times and all the seasons of our lives. Eternal God, though the skies this month have often been brilliant blue and rest on horizons that are thick with green, we know there are many still experiencing seasons of turmoil and uncertainty. There are many going through tests and treatment. There are many searching for homes or jobs. There are many with broken hearts and unfulfilled dreams. There are places where storms of struggle and winds of war bear against the doors of many homes and many hearts. So we ask that you would continue with us and bless us through this midsummer season. We give you thanks for all your goodness and faithfulness towards us. We give you thanks, O God, for ballot boxes and newspaper editorials and open borders, and for all the freedoms we enjoy. We give you thanks for diplomats and treaties and compromise for peace in a world of war. We give you thanks, O God, for police officers, streetlights, and concerned neighbours, for safety from fear and harm. We give you thanks, O God, for Paul and Peter, Martin Luther King, and Mother Teresa, for all Christians who have run the race before us. We give you thanks for scriptures and creeds and confessions, for the songs and hymns of God's people, for all good things in our heritage of faith. We give you thanks, O God, for a good creation, a redeeming Son, a transforming Spirit, for all the benefits of our salvation. We give you thanks, O God, for purple and orange sunsets, bright red flowers, great, great, great grey elephants, and the vast blackness of space. For all the wonders, God, of your creative mind, we praise you. We give you thanks, O God, for Mozart and Michelangelo and Milton, for pianos, paintbrushes, and pencils, for the wonders of our creative mind made in your image, O Lord. We give you thanks for soft beds, warm fires, familiar chairs, and open windows, for the abundant comforts of our home. We give thanks for cars that run, brand new sneakers, long hot showers, for God's goodness that flows above and beyond our needs. We give you thanks, O God, for aggressive immune systems, cross-country running, and for the sound sleep and the strength and health of our bodies. We give you thanks for crossword puzzles, learning foreign languages, and plain geometry for healthy, strong minds. We give you thanks, O God, for pesky little brothers, wise grandmothers, favourite uncles, and loving parents, and for all the families that have shaped our lives. We give you thanks for surprise phone calls, funny birthday gifts, long talks late at night, for friendships as the years go by. Eternal God and Father, we give you our thanks and our praise for the wonderful world that you have gifted to us. And hear us now as we sum up all our prayers in the words that Jesus taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Our scripture reading is from 1 Peter chapter 1, reading from verse 13 to verse 25 to the end of the chapter. 1 Peter chapter 1, reading from verse 13. Let us hear the word of God. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. Set your hope fully on the grace to be revealed when Jesus Christ is revealed. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, Be holy, because I am holy. Since you call on a Father who judges each man's work impartially, live your lives as strangers here in reverent fear. For you know that it is not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world and was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for your brothers. Love one another deeply from the heart. For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of an imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. For all men are like grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers, and the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord stands forever. And this is the word that was preached to you. Amen. We know that God will add his blessing to this reading from his truth. To his name be the glory, the honour, and the praise forever and ever. Amen. Our next item of praise is Praise My Soul. Praise My Soul.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Praise with us the God of grace. We give you thanks for your grace and your favour and all your kindness towards us, Lord. Come to us now as we ponder and meditate upon your word and upon your truth. Speak to us, for we, your servants, are listening. Guide and open our eyes and open our hearts and minds that we might understand your truth and that we might make it part of our own lives. So hear us now in all that we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I rather like the story of the man who went into an antique shop. It was filled with knick-knacks and a lot of junk, but the man was looking for a bargain. He soon found one when he looked down on the floor and found a saucer that looked to him like an ancient Chinese saucer. When he looked closer, he saw it was clearly an ancient relic from the Ming Dynasty. The man shrewdly thinks to himself, I'm going to bargain on this saucer and the steel of my life. The store owner obviously doesn't realize its value since it's filled with milk and a cat is drinking out of it. He went up to the store owner and said, this is quite a magnificent cat that you have, sir. Oh, she's really not much of a cat. I just keep her in the shop to get rid of the mice. The man said, oh, no, no, she's marvellous. I simply must have her. I tell you what, I'll give you £500 for her. The shop owner laughed. You must be kidding. £500 for this cat? She's really not worth it, but if you insist, she's yours for £500. As the man was getting out the money to pay, he slyly looked over at the saucer and said, by the way, I need something to feed my new cat from. Throw in that little saucer and I'll give you an extra £10. The owner of the store said, nothing doing. That's an ancient relic from the Ming Dynasty. It's my most prized possession. It's worth more than anything else in the shop. But you know, it's a funny thing. Since I put milk in it, I've sold 17 cats. Antiques. You're probably, most of you, familiar with the Antiques Roadshow, usually on a Sunday evening. You get the picture, the folk trot through bin, lugging their treasures and lining up at one of several tables to meet an expert. The roadshow travels from place to place. It attracts throngs of people who want to find out the value of their cherished possessions. Perhaps they've discovered an old still life painting while rummaging through an attic, or purchased an African tribal mask at a car boot sale, or inherited a Persian rug from a distant relative. The artifacts range in size from a small pair of cufflinks or a handful of army medals to gigantic dressers, tables and pinball machines. The appraiser sizes up the item and interviews the owner to discover the object's background. The expert provides a brief history lesson, identifies the item's approximate date of origin, and comments on its current condition. Then the moment of truth arrives. After asking the owner whether she has an idea of the antique's worth, the appraiser estimates its value in the marketplace. The owner gasps, and I think in previous generations, but not now, the amount was superimposed at the bottom of the television screen. And the appeal of the roadshow is widespread, and not just amongst the frequenters of thrift shops and antique fairs. After all, that hideous porcelain figurine that your grandmother gave you when she moved into the residential home might be a rarity worth £3,000. We want to know the value of what we own, and we're delighted when someone else assures us that the value is high. And of course, the programme is fascinating at a number of levels. It's fascinating to observe the expertise of those who know the antique business, as they use their specialised knowledge to identify and classify and evaluate what is brought to them. And it's thrilling for the viewer when an item which was thought to be worthless and for years had been used for some mundane purpose, is valued for a fortune. Or something that was bought in a junk shop or a jumble sale for a few pounds turns out to be worth thousands of pounds. The verses that we read from 1 Peter talk of a valuation. Peter says, "For you know, it was not with perishable things, such as silver and gold, that you were redeemed, but with the precious blood of Christ." It's appropriate to think of God's valuation of us as we find it in this verse. One of the things we learn from the world of antiques is that not all things are of equal value. In a far wider context, Jesus would have agreed with that. Jesus, for example, loved the created order. He drew lessons from the farmer sowing his seed. He glorified in the loveliness of the cornfield, its golden stalks swaying in the wind. He delighted in the birds of the air, in the flowers of the field, in the colours of the morning and evening sky, in the wind, the rain, the sun, all of them figure in his teaching. Yet Jesus did not regard everything in the world of nature as of equal value. Looking at the wayside flowers, for example, he said to those around him, "If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today, and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith?" This was not to say that the grass and the flowers of the field had no value, but "how much more" asserts that mankind has an even higher value. It's the kind of preference that is not strange to the antiques collector. He recognizes a certain value in anything that is antique, because it is the work of man in the past. Nevertheless, his own particular choice is for objects which stir him, which give him a sense of pleasure, and to which he can relate. In the same way, God has a special concern for humanity, for he is not only God's creation, but made in God's image. That is to say, capable of fellowship with him and obedience to him. You and I have a particular value to God because he can relate to us in that special way. But another thing we pick up from the world of antiques is that a flaw can spoil the value of any object. The slightest tear in a painting, the smallest crack in a vase, a scar or a warp on a piece of wood, and its potential value is greatly reduced. Because of the flaw, it is no longer enjoys the status it once had, and its ability to give pleasure for which it was created is marred. That's precisely what the scriptures teach about us. We too have a flaw. Made to bring joy to God and for fellowship with him, we have failed to realize our purpose. For of our own free will, we have chosen to live without God. We refuse to be what we were intended to be, to do what we were intended to do, to live as we were intended to live. Indeed, by our continual rejection of God, the divine image in us may be tarnished as to be almost unrecognizable. That does not mean that God does not value, that God values us any less. But he longs for us to realize the potential with which we were endowed. He yearns for us to enjoy that fellowship with us which, because of our flawed condition, he can no longer enjoy. The story in the Gospels of the lost coin and the lost sheep and the lost son remind us that even in our lost condition, we are valuable to God as that lost sheep to its shepherd, that lost coin to its owner, that lost son to his father. So valuable that he will spare no effort to seek and to find us and restore us with rejoicing when we are found. That's why his judgments on people so often confound our scale of values. Like the antique expert who can recognize the value in objects which others fail to see, the painting bought in a junk shop for a few pounds, the bowl used for no higher purpose than holding safety pins. So Jesus saw the value in people whom others considered worthless. The woman taken in adultery, Zacchaeus, the tax collector, the man who was possessed by a legion of demons. The third thing we learn from the world of antiques is that an object which has lost its value can be restored. A damaged canvas can be repaired. A wooden panel can be replaced. A crack can be filled. And the end product is an acceptable item whose status is revived. And yet that kind of work is only undertaken if the item is highly valued by its owner. For behind any restoration work of that nature, which is highly specialized, there is always a cost. In our verse, Peter is talking about our redemption and its cost. That is what the word redemption means. Redemption referred to the restoration of something which one had formerly possessed, but which one had subsequently lost. So a slave, for example, could be redeemed and thus regain their freedom. And it was done by the slave themselves paying, or someone paying on their behalf, a redemption price for their liberty. You have been redeemed, says Peter. The status you had lost is restored to you. You can fulfill the purpose for which you were created. More than that, the act of redemption is also the work of God. This is the value he has placed on you. And he also reminds them that the restoration was effected only at tremendous cost and in a currency which is not in man's possession. For you were redeemed. You were not redeemed with perishable things, such as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ. He reminds us that our redemption cost nothing less than the death of Christ. None of us will ever fully understand the mystery of the cross. All our attempts to explain what was achieved at that trysting place where heaven's love and heaven's justice meet. But this much we do know, that God was at Calvary, that there, by utterly holy and sacrificial and forgiving love, God was acting in Jesus to do something which we could never do for ourselves, and at a cost we could never meet, and that the result is that our flaw is covered so that we are acceptable to him. Horatius Bonner puts it so eloquently in his hymn, "Mine is the sin, but thine the righteousness. Mine is the guilt, but thine the cleansing blood. Here is my robe, my refuge, and my peace. Thy blood, thy righteousness, O Lord my God." Our flaw is covered, not by anything that we are, or anything that we have, or anything that we have done, but by his blood, his righteousness. Only because of that are we acceptable to God. As our earlier hymn put it, ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven. Man was created for fellowship, man fallen from fellowship, man restored for fellowship. Sometimes on the Antiques Roadshow, old communion ware will turn up and its valuers will try to put some kind of value on it. If you've been to Aberdeen Art Gallery recently, you will see that they have some communion ware for some of the churches that no longer exist in Aberdeen. And this communion ware, in an ultimate way, reminds us why the Lord left that sacrament. In itself, the communion ware is something of an antique, for it was given by our Lord the night before he was betrayed, and left as a constant reminder into succeeding generations of the value he sets on each one of us. Just think of an old chair being restored. The first thing people do when restoring old chairs is to strip away right down to the bare wood. Now we know from the Antiques Roadshow that you decrease the value of an old antique when you restore it. The original finish is much desired, but we would rather clean it and make it look new. We want to strip away all the years of grime, the garish coats of paint piled one on top of the other. We want to get rid of all the junk that's been tacked on through the years and try to find the solid, simple thing that is underneath. And we're like that old chair, needing that stripping process. Every now and then we have to take a hard, really hard look at the illusions we have built up in ourselves and our society, all that keeps us from being the true children of faith. Sometimes it's hard work to let God forgive us. Even harder sometimes to forgive ourselves. We have to discover the original finish, the true nature of being a child of God, embraced by grace. And we find that that self under all these coats that we have added. We need to strip away all the cynicism and the anger built up, to get rid of all the junk we have taken on, to defy our disappointments and find what is real again. If your trust is in anything but God and his goodness, you'll discover that your priceless vase really is a fake. Your canvas by Cezanne is a rather crummy copy, and the house of your dreams is doomed by an awful appraisal. God pulls us back to where we belong and provides us a sense of peace in this world and the next. God creates a community out of where we can build up each other in love. A place where our deepest desires are met and where the gifts we need for an existence that is abundant. There may not be a lost Picasso waiting for us in God's house, but we can be sure to find a sense of peace that is priceless. A faith community has a value in embracing one another regardless of age or infirmity or colour or class or skill or maturity, and seeing each other as true hidden treasures of this world and of our God. And to his name be the glory and the honour and the praise forever and ever. So we come to God in prayer as we bring to him our prayers for others. Let us pray. Compassionate God, we yearn for the day when all tears are dried, all pain is abandoned, and all weariness is gone. But we know that today is not that day. And so our prayers are for those who weep or are weary or are weak this morning. We pray for those who have lost someone they love. We pray for those who battle with illness in body, mind, and spirit. We pray for those facing adversities in their daily living that weigh very heavy and are perhaps too much for them to bear. Our Father, we remember all those in need in this time, mourning, sick, lonely, and in pain. We think of them in our mind's eye, in our hearts. Lord, they need to hear your promise through the heartache and the loss. They need to sense the hope that comes from your words. I am making all things new. Holy Spirit, we yearn for the day when nation will no longer fight with nation, and young men and women will not be sent to die in war, when the animosity between peoples will come to an end. But today is not that day. So our prayers are for those who wage war. Politicians, military leaders, those in the front lines, and those civilians caught in the crossfire. We pray for all our world leaders at present time, especially those gathered in Cornwall for the G7. Grant that as a result of their decisions, ways will be found to make our world a more peaceful place, a more just place. We pray for areas of conflict in the world, some that have been on our radars recently. We think of the Holy Land and Palestine and the conflict there. We think of other places of conflict and war. We pray for peace. We think of all the areas of tension in the world. We think of Syria and all that has transpired there in recent years. We think of the situation in Venezuela. We think of other places of conflict. We pray for the situation in Hong Kong, all areas of unrest and strife. So through the gunfire, the smoke, may your cry for a different way of being still be heard, whispering over the hatred, "I am making all things new." So bring peace to our world, Lord, to all areas of conflict and civil unrest. Christ of the Church, we yearn for the day when every one of those who seek to follow you will be truly one, and when those divisions that impair your body will be no more. But today is not that day. So our prayers are for those who struggle to love their fellow Christians, who find it hard to accept differences in belief that they see, who wrestle with strong feelings of anger or resentment for their brother and sister in you. Through the power struggles and the infighting, the coup receptions and the stony silences, speak your words to your people once more. "I am making all things new." Our Father, we take a moment in the silence of this house of God to offer our own individual prayers and desires and intentions to you, for those who are close to us, for those who, for whom we are burdened. Hear our prayers as we ask you now and commit to you those who need your help. So, eternal God, be pleased to hear our prayers. Today may not be that day when tears are dried, when wars are over, and when your people are one. But it is coming in us and through us, if need be, despite of us. We step ever closer to the day of a new heaven and a new earth, when you, upon your throne, the universe reverberates to the song, "I am making all things new." Be pleased then to hear and to answer our prayers. Receive the glory and the honour that is your due, and all we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our final item of praise, "There is a Redeemer."
Oh,
benediction. Would you all please stand? Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you this day and forevermore.